Okay, so this is our panel. Let me get the title of it. You belong here, overcoming imposter syndrome to expand your opportunities in that particular sequence of syllable usage. I'm Chris DeLeon. If you want to go down, just sort of say your names first. We'll kind of do more of an introduction in a moment.
I'm Juan Vaca.
I'm Lisa Brown.
Tap it.
I'm Omowale Oniyide.
And today we'll be talking about overcoming imposter syndrome. We're super open to questions, so at any point, we'll try to have a pocket of time at the end to also discuss questions. But if we say something, we're like, oh, I have something I need to add to that. Just do it. I think we also have a wireless mic that we will hand to you so you can be recorded, because we're being recorded, so they can make sure they catch what you have to say as well. I'll put this on the water bottle. Seems safe enough. But for starters, just briefly so people have some context of what they're hearing in terms of who they're hearing it from. If you want to start off with just like a brief bit of your background, your kind of situation, and or kind of current project for context, just so they, because otherwise, you know who it's coming from.
My name's Juan. I am a game developer at Telltale Games. I have my own like personal history of like mental health, and this has been like a big thing for me in, being a game developer, coming to IndieCade, coming to other talks. I always feel like really quiet and really shy. And so it kind of sometimes tends to feel like, I don't belong here because I'm afraid to make friends or I'm afraid to like talk to other people. And, it was my idea to actually have this, talk with Chris because, games should be about inclusivity, and the more that we can all make games, everyone's voice like matters.
So my name's Lisa. I'm a independent game developer. I'm a designer by trade. I worked in AAA for about 6 years at Insomniac Games, and then I went indie just this year, and have been working on Hyperlight Drifter. I just released my own small personal game called Imaginal, which is a game about catching lightning bugs. And I also stream game development and just design analysis and try and help other people learn about design. My background, I went a long time before figuring out I even wanted to be a game designer. So I went to school for art and computer science. I worked in the theater for a while. I worked in web development. It wasn't until my second semester of graduate school that I even thought game designer might be a thing. So I come from the experience where I see a lot of people who they like knew they wanted to be a game designer the minute they picked up a controller. And even though games were always important to me, I didn't have that realization until much, much later. So sometimes that's been a source of like question about my own authenticity. And I also have the experience where even when I was in AAA, I was sort of like walking this border between AAA and indie. And so it felt like a little bit like not belonging anywhere. So that's another source of where these feelings can come from me personally.
And my name is Omowale, but I go by Wale for short. And I actually got into gaming less than 2 years ago when I came to IndieCade for the first time. I had no idea that this existed. And I always feel like an outsider because I didn't grow up in gaming culture. And I have an interesting perspective since I think I was an outsider for so long. So I run Indie Dev Club, which is a Los Angeles meetup group. If you guys are in LA, you should join it. We'd love to have you. And I just finished up this kind of alternate reality experience called Sherlock Holmes and the Internet of Things.
And I'm Chris. I spent a little bit of time in AAA, a little bit of time with the startup scene, making mobile iPhone games as well. Done a whole bunch of tiny experimental prototypey projects, and I've kind of awkwardly like tried teaching university for a bit. I feel like I'm in this intersection where I'm industrial enough in my interest to annoy academics, and academic enough in my interest to annoy the industry people. Which has left me sort of in this weird, like, I'm going to teach totally independently on the internet, which so far so good, but it just puts me in this kind of weird spot. And I'm also from the Midwest, which means that in these big cities for the past 10 years, I just kind of constantly feel like a fish out of water when there's a crowd of people, and I just don't know what to do with like my hands and eye contact and stuff to not make someone think I don't know. That's precisely the problem. Now, because imposter syndrome can mean so many different things to so many different people, while the goal of this panel is not to spend an hour talking about what it is, I think it would be useful for people to hear, like, what angle or definition do you kind of have in mind when you're talking about it today, since there's so many angles and kind of ways people can think about it.
For me, one of the things about imposter syndrome is I've kind of been dealing with it my entire life, and that comes from, you know, my upbringing of being like a half sibling. Like, I don't have any full siblings, so it's like I feel like, oh, this is my brother, but it's my half brother. Like, it's not my real brother. When I went to school at USC, I transferred in, so it was like, oh, I go to school here, but I'm a transfer. You know, then when I started working, I was a producer, and that's how I started off, and I wasn't a designer, and it was like, oh, I'm working here, but I'm not doing the stuff that I was doing. And then I think this is where, you know, we started talking about, like, these big buts that you put on yourself, you know, like you say, you know, I do this, you know, but, and then you disqualify yourself, and, you know, whether it's something as, you know, as your role and your definition that you describe yourself or what you're working, or any attribute that you're saying, this is who I am. You know, I think really, really being proud of what you do and feeling natural is a big part of overcoming this.
Yeah. So for me, like, imposter syndrome is basically, you know, when you feel like you're a fraud and everyone's going to find out, even when people who are close to you and really brilliant assure you that you have skills and are talented, and you keep, like you said, finding excuses to discredit yourself. And I do that a lot, and it seems like no matter what context in games you're in, there's always a chance to do that. So, like, when you work in AAA and someone finds out you worked on this big game, and they come and are like, oh, I loved that game, and you think, oh yeah, I worked on that game, but I was just one member of this huge team, so I only did this small part, so I feel like I can't say that's my game. And on the opposite end, when you work on a small, like, title that you made completely by yourself, it's the other end. It's like, well, it's just a small game, it's just like a little game. So there's always, no matter what you do or where you are, you'll always find a way to like discredit what you do. And I think for me, it sort of developed out of a number of things. One was, I was like, oh, I should, humility is a virtue, so I should try and be humble about all things. But that can be pendulous. So that's a lot of it comes from me. Another source of it from me, I have a chronic illness. And so when I was growing up, it wasn't diagnosed yet, and I was tired and in pain all the time, and I saw everyone else doing all these things that I really struggled with, and I was like, man, I must just be lazy. That I guess I'm just like really lazy because no one else is having trouble and I am. So it started that habit early of discounting myself. And it's a really hard thing to break out of, even if you do develop skills or talents. It's always, it's like, it's really, it plagues everyone in a way.
For me, it's coming in at like two angles. So the types of games that I work on aren't part of what most people I encounter consider traditional gaming. So I always have this outsider imposter feeling because it's like, oh, well, you don't make, like, video games. Those aren't, like, real games. Those are, like, something else. The other way that it impacts me is when I go out, especially when I run, like, my meetups, when you are out and about and you don't necessarily see people that reflect yourself, and I don't mean just race, but just, like, interests, sometimes you just feel like, well, one of these is not like the other. So you feel out of place, like, quite often. So I've had to get over, just certain blocks about whether or not I actually belong in this space. And I was very fortunate enough to find a group of people to support me, but not everyone is that fortunate sometimes.
Gotcha. And so one of the ways I'm looking at it is in the sort of category for when you do get any kind of awards, recognition, whatever, chance to speak, et cetera, we call into question, like, oh, it's just because I knew the right person, or I was in the right place at the right time. Like, anybody else in the same situation would have had the exact same thing happen. and then struggling with realizing, like, yeah, but that's like 100% of the time always the case for anyone who's ever in any of those situations. And still, someone involved had to have made that kind of like choice out of all the different things that are considered. But it's so many different forms it takes for us. Now, to cut kind of right to the chase with it, what are some strategies or ways of looking at it that you found have helped with your sort of particular way of looking at it?
Do you want to start at this end?
We went over this too. All right, the very first thing that comes to mind is actually social media. If you're not on social media, if you're not on Twitter or Tumblr or just some place where you can like put your voice out into the world and see who responds back to you, you're definitely cutting yourself off. So get on it if you're not on it yet.
It's kind of that like you miss 100% of the shots you don't take kind of thing.
Yeah.
I think for me, finding, like you mentioned, finding a support network, like people, mentors are especially helpful for this, or friends, like colleagues who you can open up to about like how you feel out of place, and they can, the trick is believing them when they reassure you. Like a thing that can happen a lot is no matter what anyone tells you, you can be like, well, they're just saying that because of this, that, or the other. But if you look at it from the angle of if someone is telling you that you're doing great work or interesting work, and you trust that person and you think highly of them, and you think they're a smart person, well, it's like, well, if they're a smart person, you should trust them and believe them that what they're saying is actually, you know, is actually valid. And so for me, what I do is, you know, if someone gives me a compliment or says something kind about my work, and my gut instinct is to think of those buts, I just stop and say thank you and nothing else, and just like, I'm not going to say anything, I'm just going to say thank you at first, and keep myself, it's like physically restraining myself from getting into that spiral. So some of it is just, you know, purely strategies like that, where it's like, okay, I know this is coming, so when the situation happens, I'm just gonna say thank you. Yeah. Like, if you don't know how, I don't know how to take a compliment, just say thank you.
That actually reminds me of the same sort of like way that, as especially total beginners in game development, when you're first doing playtesting and you want to be defensive about any sort of feedback you get, which obviously is super destructive and not what you should do, argue with them over like, no, here's why it's that. We'd be like, we feel the same thing about feedback towards ourselves. We're like a reflex, but like, it's exactly like the other feedback. You listen to it, you figure if it needs a filter, you'll put it on there later. But you don't have to fight it out then.
I think one of the big issues that I deal with is that like my opinion is valid, you know, and I seek some type of like validation at work where it's like, hey, I have this idea, you know, and it may get shot down, you know, but the fact that, you know, you can bring it up, you know, I think that's the most important part is overcoming that, you know, challenge in yourself to like raise up and say, you know what, I really want to try this thing. Because here's the thing, if you have a great idea, you know, someone else might be willing to and excited to like work on it, you know, but if you don't say anything, if you don't try it, like it's never going to be made, you know, and that's why it's important that, you know, you as yourself say, this is my voice, this is what I want to make, and there's nothing wrong with, you know, with my opinion.
I think that a lot of people who suffer from imposter syndrome, they have a tendency to look at advice that is not intended for them.
Yes, very like, much so.
Because there's a lot of things out there about not being arrogant, right? And, you know, some people need to hear that. But if you have imposter syndrome, like you think that's about you, and you're like, oh, well, I shouldn't be arrogant. And so you swing too far in the other direction. So being able to recognize that being able to contextualize who advice is for, because, you know, you'll hear people giving really harsh feedback to especially people trying to get into games to let them know that, hey, this is really hard. And like some people, like you mentioned, if they're just getting started and doing playtest feedback and they'll want to argue about everything. And so there's a lot of harsh advice to be like, you need to drop your ego. Which is good, useful, relevant advice, but if you suffer from imposter syndrome, then you think, oh, that's about me, and and you feel bad. You haven't even done anything, and you feel bad about yourself because you're like, oh no.
I think another thing for me that's really helped too is, you know, to really, you know, quantify and say like, this is what I'm doing. So, you know, if you are a student, you know, and you have, or not even a student, if you're a game developer, if you're a designer and you have aspiring in your resume or on your business card, get rid of it. Like cut it out, you know, like give yourself the credit. You know, if you design games, you're a game designer. Like it's that simple. You know, if you, you know, like one of my favorite like old quotes is like, you know, the journey of 1,000 miles starts with one step, you know, but after 3 steps, you're walking. You know, it might take you a while, but you're walking. You know, you wouldn't say, oh, I'm not a walker, like, yeah, at this point. So, you know, really, really, you know, validate yourself, you know, and if you're working on games right now, you are a game developer.
And qualify the people who speak to you. Like, as an outsider coming in the last 2 years, gaming is so vast. Nobody really knows, like, you know, there are no definite terms for, like, what you're doing. So if anyone comes along and tells you, oh, you do X, Y, Z, that doesn't count, don't let them just dismiss you. Like, challenge them. Have them, like, actually, like, you know, explain why whatever you're doing doesn't count or whatever you're doing is wrong. Sometimes, you know, the feedback will help you grow, but sometimes you'll realize you're hanging around the wrong people.
Yeah, absolutely. It's the kind of thing where, like, the even among, like, first-person shooter console game fans, they'll look at each other's games and be like, well, that doesn't count. Mm-hmm. And, like, so let alone the gap between, like, alternate reality and social Facebook games and, like, the weird spectrum of stuff at IndieCade and so on, which is awesome, all of it. Yes, absolutely. Sometimes you're just kind of like, maybe that's not the right crowd for feedback and stuff. I really like your point, Juan, of, like, the kind of, like, you can bring it up. You can try it. One of my favorite Keith Olbermann quotes I wanted to make sure I worked in here was that the world bursts at the seams with people ready to tell you you're not good enough. On occasion, some may be correct, but do not do their work for them. Seek any job, ask anyone out, pursue any goal. Don't take it personally when they say no. They may not be smart enough to say yes. And it's just this point of, like, you know, I try to focus on, like, the gauge yourself by, did you at least try at it, right? And then if you did and you feel good about it and maybe the idea failed, but, like, you tried it, and then you're probably better prepared for the next thing. What is there a specific thing that's happened that's helped you feel empowered in the game development scene? I do kind of share sort of the...
Something I did, it was last year at E3, Glitch City had a demo night, which is, you know, they invite people to give 5-minute talks. And I'd never like done something like that. And I was firmly in AAA at the time, but I'd been hanging around the scene. And I was like, someone invited me. They're like, hey, would you like to give a talk? I was like, sure. And so I gave this 5-minute talk that I wasn't sure if it was very abstract. It was about level design, but it wasn't really. It was secretly about, like, subconscious creativity, and it was kind of scary because they invited me. They're like, "Oh, we're doing this thing next week. Do you want to give a talk?" And I was like, I was so terrified. I was like, "That's not long enough to prepare," but I said yes anyway. I was like, "Yes, sure, I'll do it," and I sort of forced myself into an uncomfortable situation. And I ended up giving the talk, and it really resonated with a lot of people. A lot of people came up afterwards and talked to me about it, and sometimes people still even come up to me and they're like, oh, you gave that level design talk, that demo night, and it was really validating. So that really helped, doing something where I got validating feedback. But in order to do that, like, I had to sort of trick myself. I said yes before I knew what I was doing, and I was aware of that. I was, because practical Lisa would have been like, well, I'm very busy at work, and a week isn't very long to prepare, and, you know, what if I don't really know what I'm going to have to say, but instead I was just like, yes, and I'm like, okay, I've committed now. Now I have to come up with something. Now I have to do it. So there have been several times in my life where that sort of happened, where there's been something that I've been really afraid or not confident about doing, but I agreed to do it before I had a plan for what I was actually doing. I just said, yes, I'll do this, which can be terrifying, but it's also motivating, because then you're like, it's kind of like when, if you're working on a game and you're sort of fiddling along and you're not sure of your progress, and at least at a big company, what I would do is I would schedule a meeting to show off the game to my leads. I would just put it in Outlook, and then I had a date, and they all said yes, and I was like, well, now I have to get it in shape because I'm showing it on this date. So it's a little trick to force yourself into uncomfortable situations.
Yeah, I actually have pins. If anyone wants one, they're essentially encouraging you to get out of your comfort zone, and it's this bear holding this little sign, and it looks very mean and vicious, but it's like, get out of your comfort zone, comfy zone. But what I did is I just, like what Lisa said, like I just literally like pushed myself out there to just like meet people. When opportunities came up, I would just say yes, and learn the most that I possibly can. And that's taken me very, very far. Like, if you have someone that you want to approach, ask them. If they say no, okay, move on to the next person. But you never know who'll say yes until you actually ask them.
Yeah, I think, you know, this is a little bit, you know, off par, but for me, you know, in my own struggles, you know, with mental health, like part of it has been, you know, talking about it and having the courage to bring it up, you know, and I think in doing so, I'm able to say like, this is how I feel, and I'm able to share these things, and, you know, through that little bit of courage, I'm able to find out that, you know, I'm not alone, and I'm not the only person that's feeling this way, whether it's anxiety or depression or imposter syndrome or anything else. And I think that, you know, being able to talk about these things is, you know, beneficial because we're able to connect with other people that might be feeling it and share this. So I think that for me has been like an important step.
And also, like, when you make things, don't be, this is something that it took me a very long time to get over. Like, don't be afraid to like share them with people. Like, it took me a while to like get used to like, okay, I made something, but it's just like a little tiny thing. Just, you don't have to really like look at it if you don't want to. And I'll just kind of like try to give it to them, but hide it at the same time. Like, just like the faster you get something out of there, the faster you get feedback. And you won't get that feedback if you're like kind of shy.
Another story that I thought of that just recently happened, as far as things that, experiences that have made me feel better or empowered me. It's kind of funny. So I have a very dear friend who is an amazing designer. He's been in the games industry for like 10 years. He's probably the most brilliant systems designer I've ever met. And he recently accepted a job as a lead designer for a place. And he just last week was expressing like his fear of this. He's like, what if I don't know what I'm doing? I don't know if I can do this. And I'm like, what are you talking about? You're the most brilliant systems designers I've ever known, and you've like aspired to this. And I was actually talking about how I was going to be on this panel, and he's like, well, you can feel free to tell them about how I'm an actual imposter. And I'm like, no, you're not. But it made me realize what was happening was he was doing something that like, you know, he hasn't been a lead yet, so he doesn't have that experience yet. But he's totally qualified for it. But the fact that, you know, he's never done that before, and now he's doing it. And it's like, well, if you don't do something that's outside of your experience level, you're never going to grow. So if you aspire to grow, you're going to have to be in a situation where you are responsible for something that you know you don't have the experience yet, and you're in the act of getting that experience. So, like, talking with him and reassuring him, like, it gave me perspective. It's like, well, if this person who's, like, a friend and mentor to me and who has all this experience and is very smart, he also has these fears.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, well, everybody has them.
It's like there's, like, a sanity check that, like, it doesn't go away. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's only, it only affects us as much as we let it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think those are all excellent points. With Wally's note about like showing your work to people, I feel like, and so there are many ways, and I want to begin by disclaiming I'm not anti-school, but there are certain things that school puts patterns in us, like by the time I show someone something, it's ready for a grade. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it will be assessed, and I will be judged by that. Whereas in real life, after school, typically when you're showing someone something, it's like, it's your way to improve something. You'll hear back about it, but it's not over. There are games we see here at IndieCade that I have seen for years being shown to people in corners of booths of other conferences, when people travel around, people are just visiting friends, and the game's so much better because they kept showing it in this incomplete state month after month, conference after conference, trip after trip. But yeah, by all means, like, showing people work isn't that, like, and this is the final state it ever has to be in. And you also don't have to apologize for it. They're like, this is what I'm working on. Check it out.
Oh, yeah, that.
It's part of the dialogue.
A friend of mine, she was doing the thing where she made a game every week, and when she showed it, she would always apologize. So this isn't, you know, or sorry, this isn't finished. And I was like, if you apologize one more time when you show me this, I'm going to fight you. Stop it. Stop apologizing when you show someone stuff. Because it's like a little disclaimer. You're like, oh, I'm like hoping you will soften the blow by disqualifying this somehow. And it's a hard habit to break. I mean, I do it. I noticed myself doing it for something once, and I was like, oh, I'm doing that thing. But it's very easy to fall into when you have something you're showing someone. You're like, oh, this isn't finished yet. Or keep in mind that this is a, like, don't just stop. Stop doing that. And if you can work on catching yourself when you start to apologize, like, it's a lot of work just to do that. So that's a good starting strategy.
Yeah, so when I was briefly teaching in university, there was a student who would always start her presentations with, like, I just started this last night. She had 3 weeks to do it. Now, if she hadn't said that, I wouldn't have been able to have told, and it would have looked pretty reasonable. But as soon as she said that, I was like, aha, yes.
Yeah, don't disqualify yourself.
And don't think that there's going to be this magical set of circumstances where, like, you'll somehow be eventually ready to present something perfect. Like, favorable conditions never come.
And or so, like, whenever an opportunity does arise to, like, hey, so one of my first little moments where part of what got me indirectly involved in IndieCade, I had a game that was a nominee or finalist, whatever, 5 years ago. We were in Artistry Games in Atlanta, unrelated to this. There was an IGDA meeting out there, and they're like, okay, who wants to show their thing for 3 minutes? And they just had a long series of things sign up. And I was like, okay, I have this little experimental gameplay thing I've been doing. Showed that, and afterwards people were like, oh, you should submit this stuff to IndieCade. And I was like, oh, I guess I should. but I had to have had that thing in existence, which people had ignored for the first year and a half it existed, to have been able to have that ready to wave and show when it was like, hey, who wants to show something? I'm like, I'll try this. But yeah, you got to be kind of ready for those before they arise. By the time those opportunities come up, it's kind of like, oftentimes, that train is passing. And you got to kind of, but more will come. So you start getting ready for the next one in that situation. But so you also,
actually, I want to piggyback onto that. So even in the event that you do get a game in, you do submit, and you get like all this like great reception, you might feel like the rate at which it came, you're just like, well, I'm on this like spotlight, and how did you do it? And there's like press, and people are asking you questions, and you may not have the answers, and that can be a little overwhelming. Or more importantly, for your next project, it'll be overwhelming, and you'll have to try to think like, well, lightning has to strike twice, or something like that. And I remember that when I was in school, we had a talk, and Amy Hennig came and like talked to us, and it was right in between. It was right as Uncharted 3 was coming out, and she said that, you know, when Uncharted 2 came out, it was like such a great game, and it received like all this praise, and like immediately as they were done, they're like, all right, Uncharted 3, like, let's get back at it. And they, like, even, you know, a creative, professional, established writer like her still has that, well, what do we do next kind of step. And I think it's really, you know, by challenging yourself and, you know, believing in yourself and taking the steps to, you know, to write the stuff down, to try your prototypes, to be okay with failing, is a crucial step in, you know, figuring out what your next steps are for your next games.
Yeah, I think that's really, I mean, so certainly there are lots of indies we run into here who have had very successful title or two and then feel super duper stressed out, imposter syndrome, and find a different angle of how in the heck do I ever follow that? Did I deserve that kind of level of recognition in the first place? And in many cases too, it can kind of mess with the process, because like that's not the mentality they had when they built that thing that took them 6 years of random school projects, kind of inspiring, getting up to this other thing, and now they're kind of back on square one of like, well, now what? And I like to think, I like, so even professional athletes and stuff, you know, they'll spend their whole careers trying to become a better batter to still get, like, they won't hit every ball, and when they do, it still won't be a home run every time. And I think sometimes we put this unfair pressure on. These are creative projects. They're all kind of shots in the dark. They're all kind of apples and oranges. And the platforms keep changing. Technology keeps changing. Anybody, you know, and I felt this way about, as a super visible game developer, Will Wright, where, like, when people would see his games, they put so much pressure on Spore because of his past projects and so on. But it's like, it's a creative project. Every single one of these things, even with good process, feedback, et cetera, is another chance, another roll, another die roll.
I have something I want to piggyback on that, which is being mindful in how you can make other people feel imposter syndrome when you are not necessarily trying to do that. And it works two ways. So going back to that story about how I gave that talk about level design, but it wasn't actually about level design. Someone who it resonated with, I became friends with, and we chatted. And I remember sometime later, like on Twitter or something, they said that they aspired to be as good a level designer as me. And I thought, okay, I know for a fact this person has never played a game of mine where my level design has been in the forefront. One, because he never played any of my games, period. But the AAA games I'd worked on that were out at the time, it was mostly just like combat design oriented, and the level design work that inspired that talk was on a game that hadn't released yet. So I was like, I know he's never played my work. I know he has no idea how good of a level designer I am, but he said that, and it made me feel really awkward. It's like, well, if he's giving me that praise and I know for a fact that it's not based on anything, then it made me question any praise that I get. So something to be aware of is often when you see like a developer that you admire, you can often put them on a pedestal and imagine that they are really good at all these things because they spoke at a conference or something, or they gave a talk that inspired you, and you can sort of fill in the gaps thinking that they're this amazing designer with all these skills. And that does two things. One, it gives you an unrealistic expectation of other developers that can make you feel like a fraud because you're like, oh, well, I'll never be as good. Yeah, look at how high the bar is. But two, it can make those people feel like a fraud because you're not putting realistic expectations on them. And they're like me. It's like, well, I know that person doesn't know what my level design skills are. They've never played my games. Why would they say that? And what if everyone giving me praise is doing it from that angle? So be mindful of that when you're admiring someone's work. I think in hindsight, something that would have helped would have been like, well, which level did you like? Tell me about that. Or maybe if you're talking to a developer and you want to tell them about what you admire, you know, maybe be specific. Those times have been really great when people have come up and they're like, I really liked this game you worked on, this specific part, I really liked it. I was like, oh yeah, I was actually involved in that. Or, you know, it gives some context. But it's very easy to look at other developers you admire and assume that they are way more skilled than, they're just people. They're just developers like you and me.
And I love that too, because there was that point where someone had to kind of pretend they knew your work.
Yes.
As a way of saying that, like, you're interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Which it's actually completely okay to say, like, I haven't played your game yet, but I find your attitude about these things fascinating.
Right,
it's
right.
It's totally okay, but it doesn't throw you off maybe in the same way.
Yes.
Yeah, and on the, still in that same vein, but on the other side, I went to a playtesting night, like, a year ago in L.A., and I was sitting next to a student that was fresh out and a woman that would be considered an older woman. And so she said, oh, guess what I'm here for? And he said, oh, you're someone's grandmother.
Aww.
And no, she was an actual, like, game designer. And that was very, 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 like, he had a little shocking moment. So don't discount people when you see them. Like, anyone can be a game developer. Don't be that person.
So the subject brought up like the sort of the accidental slight of we're like, oh, I didn't mean to. Mm-hmm. But so now also, it was actually almost an amazing response where it was like, oh, how do we feel better about imposter syndrome? We're like, join social media. We're like, recently we've been hearing stories where like, that's part of, we're like, hide from social media is sometimes the way to avoid. So I feel like it's worth us directly approaching, how do you deal with jerks? Straight up people, they are after you. It is not even like an accident that they're like, who the hell do you think you are?
Well, okay, so I will say that I was a social media intern for 1 year, so I do have like a certain experience in how to like navigate. But even if you like know a little bit, you still can find yourself in trouble. So how do you deal with jerks? What I do is I kind of like monitor. I try my best to like monitor the tone of a conversation. And if I see someone that's trying to like pull me in a certain direction, I'll ignore them. Or I'll just give like a very like short little response and I'll just move on to something else. I won't let them pull me into like a really like dangerous area. But it can get a bit tricky. I suggest that when you're using social media, you don't use it as yourself. You develop a persona of how you want the world to perceive you. This might sound very dark, but just think of it as, okay, if I die tomorrow, what's going to be up there? How do I actually want to be like remembered versus did I have a really bad day and I want to rant about this particular company? So you have to be very sensitive when you're on social media and like develop this persona that's not you so that when people are attacking you, it's that persona, that mask, that's the best, most ideal version of you and not like your actual self.
Can I specific to that persona point? For the longest time, I did not want to have or do or be a brand. I was like, I'm going to be Chris DeLeon. That's going to be everyone, just my name.com, my name on Twitter and so on. And what I've eventually realized from like, well, I would just keep shifting web domains. So I just interaction artist for a while, hobby game dev for a while. Now I'm game devs like you. But like these sort of like brands in a sense, they become like snake skins you can shed. It's an identity you can move on from. It's like, oh, I was doing experimental gameplay projects, but now I'm doing this podcast stuff. In a way that when it was just my name, like, I was stuck in it. And I was just sort of like, I couldn't, whatever arguments people had with that, well, whatever arguments they had with the old brands, like, those are old history. That brand no longer exists. That thing's died. That's a gravestone now. Yeah, but I super agree with that kind of, like, doesn't have to be you. And, like, the very complete, you know. Yeah.
I try to come from it from just a, I try to not to get like too emotionally wrapped around it because all I can take is like one bad comment to kind of throw everything, like all the good praise that you've gotten for it. Like you can get 100 positive reviews, but that one, I really hate this game, like will stick with you, you know? And I think, you know, just understanding that, you know, not everything's for everyone, you know, and everyone can have their own opinion and you don't necessarily need to be baited into it and go back or have to have the last word or explain yourself to it. I think it's fine. It's just, sorry that it wasn't for you. I don't need the negative.
How many of you like Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown? So the reason why I raise that question is to point out even world famous best-selling things don't appeal to everybody. And we forget this sometimes, and we make like a little indie thing, and there's some people who like it's not their thing. They're like, oh my god, it needs to be everyone's thing. I failed at it. No, like, nothing in the universe, no movie. Some people don't like Star Wars. I know. But
I would jump on with this how to deal with jerks thing, with the caveat that you know, severe harassment and abuse is its own like kettle of fish. That's like a whole different thing. But just as far as people being jerks, I actually have an easier time dealing with that than I do with praise. Because when it's someone being like, they're not being helpful, they're just trying to tear me down, I have an easier time objectifying it and being like, oh, this is what's happening, and I'm just going to deal with that in a logical way. Or like, you know, again, turn to my support network and I have an easier time, like, maybe, is there anything useful I can get out of this? Maybe I'll extract that and then just, you know, whatever. So I actually have a lot easier time dealing with the negative stuff than I do with the positive stuff that I might fret, might be undeserved. But yeah, caveat, that's different. People being a jerk is different than people whose lives are ruined by abuse. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
And I wanted to ask, where do we get these ideas of, like, who an ideal game developer is? Who is this mythical figure of, like, the master craftsman that can just create things and appeal to everyone and get everybody's love and sell millions and millions? Or, like, where do we, like, get this idea? Who is this person? What are they supposed to look like? And what are they supposed to
represent?
I think it's literally Shigeru Miyamoto and no one else alive.
I would say that, yes. I would say that especially with indie developers, I've noticed that we put an inordinate and probably unhealthy amount of weight on the accolades of our peers, when in a lot of cases that doesn't actually matter. So someone will give a talk, and like I mentioned earlier, all of a sudden that person is the best person at that thing. And actually, I think working in AAA has given me perspective, because I know a lot of developers who are master craftsmen at their skill, but who don't, you know, they're like hermits on the mountain, right? They're like masterful, but they don't give talks or whatever, so people don't know them. People wouldn't know. Whereas, you know, if you might give, once you give one talk, then people will start inviting you to more talks, because they're like, oh, that person gave a pretty good talk. They must be an expert in their field, and they're good at talking. And you get invited to many talks after that, which is a shame, because there's a lot of brilliant people with insightful things to say that the opportunities to share that don't come easily. So I think just being mindful of that, being mindful of, like, the developers that everyone writes about or that speak a lot and that are very visible, that, you know, they're just good at talking, and they get invited to a lot of talks, so you see them a lot. So it's not a one-to-one, like, representation of how, of the idealness of their skills. It's, you know.
And I really like your point of, like, good at talking. Well, and so, like, you raised the point that, like, it's partly defined by, like, things at IndieCade, mm-hmm. things at IGF, and so on. And so I think it's been helpful to think of it not as, like, there's a best, mm-hmm. but instead it's almost more like relationships, where there's a best fit, there's a best match, there's a certain thing of, like, even if you're making projects, is, like, was it an IndieCade kind of thing? Is it an IGF kind of thing? Maybe it's an actually sells copies kind of thing, which turns out is a third category with some overlap.
Yeah.
That's definitely not a subset of either.
Last night at Night Games, we played a game that didn't make it into the showcase, but it was amazing. I had fun, and I'm going to buy it. So, yeah.
Let
me repeat the question, sir, for the recording.
Okay.
So the question being from, how do you handle giving feedback on a project where someone's like, oh, look at my thing, and it visibly needs so much work, maybe you're even struggling to, like, give them concrete, specific answers to that?
So I would say there are two things that you have to keep in mind. Not everyone can take feedback, even if it's, like, actual, like, good critical feedback. And you have to just always keep that in mind and just, like, push that aside. But don't make it personal. Don't make it, don't phrase it in such a way that this game sucks because you suck. Because I've had that happen to me, actually. I got someone to tell me that, like, I should. My very first game that I, like, put out into the world and I wanted to get feedback on, like, you know, just for help, someone just totally, like, almost destroyed me because they made it personal. So don't make it personal about the person. You can say, you know, you have some things you need to work on. You find one critical point that you do. There's something that they're doing that you can, like, you know, like, focus on, saying, like, I really like this, or I liked what you were doing with that, but the rest of it needs to be, like, worked on in this way. And you're specific. Be very, very specific so that they can actually know, like, what it was that you didn't like. Don't just say, like, it sucked.
Yeah.
You know?
There's somebody that at work that I worked with whose feedback, like, during reviews would just be, this sucks, you know? And that's damaging to the artist, and it's also, you know, not helpful in any kind of way, because it doesn't tell you how to improve. So for me, like, what I would do is, I would reverse it and put it back on the designer, you know, and I would say, okay, well, what was your intent? You know, like, walk me through it. Why couldn't we get there? And then, you know, now that you know, like, where the problem and the misconnect was, try to say, like, okay, now how do we close this gap and get back on there? So that way you kind of, you know, you empathize with the designer and you say, you know, how do we fix this problem, you know, together?
Yeah, I don't consider blunt feedback to be being a jerk. Like Wale said, like people who are, when the we talked about people who are jerks, it's like people who are trying to tear you down. Versus like if someone gives a game that's terrible, then yeah, usually I try to make it clear what my goal is in giving the feedback and try and get what their intent is. And yeah, sometimes the best thing you can do is be honest and blunt and not sugarcoat it, but that doesn't mean tearing down the person, which is, that's where jerk territory comes in.
Yeah, so just don't make it about, don't say like, you should never make a game ever again. What the hell were you thinking? Don't frame it in that way.
So I work with lots and lots and lots of beginner people. It's for the sort of lot I've chosen in life. And so I tend to think of it, I use lots of metaphors as well, and I tend to think of it as, if someone was starting to play an instrument, someone's starting to play a sport, someone was starting to cook, any of these things, like there's a phase before they really even can benefit from pointed feedback, where it's basically like, how do you encourage that they're doing it, that you find like that's awesome that you're doing this, this is great, kind of, you know, keep them enthused about it. And the other thing I try to help them do is start to think in sort of a production mindset of, instead of how can I craft this into the perfect thing, because no meta iteration is ever going to fix this. You can't polish it, you go into a Lamborghini. That's not where Lamborghinis come from. Instead, it becomes, okay, this is great. What's left to do? How soon can you finish this game in effect so they move on? Because our worthwhile projects tend to be buried under layers and layers and layers of crud that kind of weren't worth making, except that they're the only way to get us past those mental hurdles to, like, having enough understanding of really relevant concepts to kind of make this thing we're proud of. But just trying to just help them keep moving forward instead of being stuck on, I can't release this till it's perfect. It's like, great. How soon is this coming out? When can I expect to play this? So you can work on your next thing that's not this.
Also, getting their goals. Like, you know, maybe they're just like, oh, I made this just for a game jam and I'm done with it. Or, you know, I'm just messing around. You know, that's going to contextualize things differently than, like, I'm going to get this greenlit, you know. It's so maybe, like, what are you actually asking them pointedly what their goals are with it?
Yeah, like, what was the purpose for it?
That's all good stuff. Stuff that makes them forward thinking about it. So it's like, what trajectory do you even see yourself wanting to go in? Mm-hmm. We got a relevant question here from social media.
Ooh.
It says, Jordan Striven Snell, SGWEE Striven, STRIVEN, or SGWE Striven. As it relates to first projects, how do you build up confidence by finishing versus just stewing in own anxiety?
Ooh, that's interesting.
Finishing is so hard. With people who are just getting started, like, I hammer in the importance of just getting through the pipeline of finishing something and getting something out, even if it's a game jam, just because it's the process of finishing something it's a skill that you develop with practice, and the only way you can practice finishing things is by finishing things.
Yeah.
So if, especially if you're just starting and you get caught up in that anxiety of this thing not being good enough for the world, you can practice finishing things by, you know, doing game jams, doing like challenges, like the game a week challenge is great for that. If that's the practice you need.
Yeah. Or like sketch dailies.
Yeah, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But just like getting things through the pipeline, there's so much that goes into it that you don't know until you've done it. And if you can treat it like a practical matter, like, oh, like, if you were drawing and you wanted to improve your skills, maybe you would do master copies, you know, for a while to improve your skills. It's like, this isn't your art. This is something that you're doing to improve your craft. And so if you can detach yourself from a project, be like, you know, this isn't a game that's representative of my deep inner soul. This is like me practicing getting through the pipeline. And you can detach yourself from a little bit, can help with the stewing and anxiety bit.
And for first games, like, something that always comes up is make sure that you start small, like really small. Like, if you're doing your first game, my first game was way too big, but like, whatever your idea is, like, cut it back, like, just start down. Like, something that I like to do is, like, I make like the smallest unit of experience for an idea. So, like, figure out a way to, like, okay, what's the, like, most basic, smallest little piece that can represent, like, an idea? And then I build things like little Lego blocks. Like, once I have this component done, I move on to the next one, and then I'll build in layers instead of attacking everything at once.
And I try to emphasize, too, for those of you all who have heard my other sort of materials and stuff, but, like, so for me, it's in addition to small, unoriginal. Like, for your very first project or two, straight up clone an old thing. Not to release it, not to sell it, not to try to build a brand off it, just because you're going to learn some things in the process. And if it's a personal project, if it's an original idea, we're very invested in it coming out well. We're very personally, it is an extension of you. And if it's explicitly an unreleasable clone of someone else's thing anyway, Flappy Bird, Angry Bird, kind of like basic core mechanic, Tetris, clearly don't release that. They go after people, et cetera. Then, like, you have no personal investment in it. It's not your baby to like, have come out kind of like, eh, whatever. But you're getting practice, so by the time you do your original stuff, you're just that much more comfortable in it. I really liked, your point of the kind of working on the shorter term stuff, the like, can you do a game jam thing? Can you do, like, the nightly sketches and so on? My friend Aaron McCarty has been doing the nightly Inktober?
Inktober, yeah. Mark. Yeah.
And made the positive comment, like, it makes her realize how much she relies on the input of others when she's making something normally, but when she has to start and finish in such a short period of time, she doesn't have time to let herself ask for input to be held up by that, just has to just make a thing and hope she improves in the process, which I think is often the right mentality early on of, it's like kind of we said, like, early on getting input may not even be that valuable. You just got to just push through it and keep doing stuff. We have questions over here? Sure. So like in my video courses and my training and textbooks and stuff, it sort of builds a ramp where, like, the very first thing is a very much, well, let's call it a 1970s ball and paddle genre. And that is, like, the lead. There are chips mass manufactured, not by that company. It's that game. Anyway, long story there. So in that case, like, very little innovation. You can do a little bit of modification, but each project successively after that. So when you move to one that is another genre where there's a paddle at the bottom and there's bricks and no particular trademark associated with it. In that case, like, you could add some power-ups, you could add some visual style to it. But with each project, you kind of, like, you know, features and innovations on top of it of increasing scope and complexity. Until before you know it, as soon as you're kind of a even mid-1980s kind of game where there's level spaces, those level spaces are your own. As soon as there's items to pick up, you can do all kinds of arbitrary items, power-ups, et cetera, and enemy behaviors. Pretty easy to make yours, maybe easier to make yours than what they originally should have done. And, like, each successive, I kind of use a historical ramp, you're adding more of your own flair and personality to it. Past the bare bones first kind of project or two.
I think it kind of depends on, like, where your, you know, comfort level as a developer is. I know that at school, you know, one of the very first exercises that we had was we just had to recreate, like, any one of our favorite 8-bit games. You know, it was just like, you know, what are the systems, and then you just backward engineers it to kind of make your own little version of it.
It also depends on where you're doing it. Like, the person we brought this up for is the type of person who really struggles finishing anything, and that's their challenge. That's what they're trying to work at. So yeah, in that case, it doesn't matter if it's straight Arkanoid or Arkanoid with a flare. It doesn't matter. Just finish it. Just finish the damn game. But some people, that's not their challenge. Some people, you know, they can do a game jam easily. They can finish things easily. So for them,
sometimes starting can be hard too.
Yeah.
Well, and this is part of why for the first unoriginal projects, I encourage the unoriginal remake stuff for the very, very first one or two especially, because it gives them such a clear blueprint of, they're not held up on starting of like, oh, I need to wait until I have an idea. Because part of why I tell people who don't have an idea is start building anything generic. Make a side-scrolling space shooter. Make an overhead driving car game. Because when you're in the middle of it, you can start making these very concrete ideas about your game that you couldn't have from the outset. But if they just want to do the straight clone, they literally have a model of, like, well, it's done when I get everything on the screen working. Because these are, like, old one-screen everything there games, which is just a whole different pipeline of complexity.
Yeah, it's very much about what your goal is in even doing the thing. And if your goal is to get practiced at finishing, then it doesn't matter. Just finish the game.
Was there another question back here? Yeah. I just want to repeat for the mic.
Question.
Basically, just the question about how to avoid overcommitting while still taking advantage of kind of opportunities and things and chasing your kind of ideas and so on.
I know we've been saying, like, say yes to a lot of things. say yes to new challenges. But I think, you know, one of the things that is really hard to do is to say no. And you know, when you know when to cut things from your project, when to cut things from your schedule, things from your time. And I know that it can definitely have like this big bearing on you for making things. And you know, one of the things that that has helped me a lot in my life is I've cut the word should out of my life. You know, should basically tells you, all right, this is something that I need to do, but you automatically set up this negative reinforcement if you fail to complete it, you know, and so you're kind of setting yourself up for failure if you don't finish your should task. So, you know, for me, I like as soon as I stopped getting out of that realm of like, oh, I should go to this person's, you know, game dev club, or I should, you know, email this person back, I should do these things. Then that gave me a little bit more control.
Hit your mute. Oh.
So, you know, really getting out of the that should bubble gave me more control of like my time, and that gave me you know, more time to do the things that I wanted to do.
For me, so this is kind of similar to what the answer to the previous question. It's a lot about where you are right now. If you're the sort of person who feels stagnant and like you need to grow, then saying yes to new opportunities is good. If you're the sort of person where you're like overachiever doing all the stuff and like you said, not getting value out of all the things you're doing because maybe you feel guilty about saying no, then saying no to things can be a really hard thing to practice. I've had to deal with that this past summer because my health has taken a dive and I physically cannot do as many things as I used to do. And it's hard. I've had to turn down some really cool stuff and it's really hard. And you know, having a support network for that is useful, like people who are close to me, having them tell me that they're proud of me for saying no to things is really reassuring, because you don't really hear that a lot, because usually the advice out there is for people getting started or people who are struggling to like do new things. So it's all like early on hearing the wrong advice. It's like, oh, I'm not doing enough. But you know, when you are saying no, like when you have the freedom to do all the things, saying no to something it takes a lot of strength to do that. So it, you know, it just depends on where you are. And I wanted to really quick, something this made me think of in relation to imposter syndrome is acknowledging when you have impact, acknowledging when the things you do are impacting people, because something in your life might change and you might not be able to do all the things that you used to do. And people with imposter syndrome who are like constantly trying to get better, they're like, oh, there's not enough time. You know, I have to do as many good things as I can in time. And a friend of mine, he was moving and to like a new point in his life. He's starting school and he was listing off all these things. He was like, oh, here's all the things that I accomplished in the past X years. And I was pointing out, I was like, that's awesome. You've done a lot of cool stuff. And his response was, it's not enough yet. I'm not done yet. It's like, oh, it's not that great. There's more to do. And I was like, don't do that. Take the time to acknowledge that you've done these things that have impacted people, because it's very easy to think, well, I can do these things now, so it's just going to go up in a line graph like that. And something in your life might happen, and you might not be able to do a quarter of the things you used to do. And then when you're in this mindset of, I have to get better, I have to get better, I have to do more things, then that can be devastating. So it's good to be ambitious, it's good to try and improve, but when you do something, like, don't discount it just because it's past. Take a moment to acknowledge that, like, you've had an impact in people's life, because you never know when your life is going to change dramatically.
I would say you have to develop a way to become very clear about what you want, and I know that's, like, very hard to do, figuring, like, your way out, but You have to find some way to like measure an opportunity against. Like a few years ago, I had a really bad accident, and I was actually afraid to like drive a car for like a year. But while I was getting out of that, my little like qualifier is if an opportunity comes along and I were to get into a car accident on the way to it, would I be upset that I wouldn't be able to make it, or would I be upset that I was on the way to it? So if I know that if I crashed my car, I would be upset that I was doing this because it wasn't really what I wanted to do with my time, I don't do it. So be very clear about like your time. Your time is very valuable. So if you're overcommitting and you feel like you're spreading yourself too thin, I would say it might be you have to like become a little bit clearer about where you're heading, or at least what, even if you don't know like where you want to end up, at least figure out like what experiences that you want. You have to find a way to filter things out so yeah. that you have the time to pursue them.
So I'm a big fan of the idea that a person finishing or releasing like even one mediocre project is ahead of someone else having 100 ideas a day for good projects kind of thing. Now the flip side of that is that I don't think time and energy work the way we kind of think of them as. We have these very simple mental models for like, oh, I have 10 time tokens a day. How do I spend those? When my dad and I were going around to schools and we visited Harvard, I did not get into Harvard, but we sure visited. The club, our little tour guides were school athletes. Turns out they have a lot of club sports there. And so one of the parents said, well, you know, how does it affect your grades? And the answer was they get better grades in season because their lives have structure and because they have something that they're good at, that they like doing, that helps them sort of like keep their energy levels up. And they're out of season, it's all just amorphous time where they can stay up late and sleep in and skip class and not feel that discipline. And so in many cases in my life, I'm trying to figure out like what other, so occasionally there's a side project that actually kind of serves my energy or keeps my motivation high. We're like, okay, while I'm struggling in my actual business of doing things that I'm struggling at as a business, I can simultaneously, but I sure as heck know how to do these other little things that just kind of help keep me happy. And they're an outlet. There's a book called One Thing by Keller and Papasan. I'm going to save you reading 240 pages because they're all about one thing, which is like when you're figuring out what you're doing with your time, is there one thing you can do and prioritize and support the doing of that if done will make like your next day and future tasks easier or like make the other things you're supposed to have done today irrelevant. And like it's just this handy filter of how do I kind of change the course that I'm on. That's anyway, sort of my bit on the time stuff.
I think that the turning down things, it can be really difficult, especially if it's something where you're like, this is important work and I have to say no to it. And a mentor of mine when I was struggling with this, he's like, you know, it's really hard, but imagine that important work's still getting done. It's someone else is still going to do it. And thinking about delegating, like I actually, as an example, like if I have to turn something down, I think about who's someone else who would be good for this that maybe I can suggest they ask. And it actually happened with Wale because I got invited to speak a talk in Dubai. And I couldn't do it for a number of reasons. I was like so bummed. I was like, who would be good for this? And it was all about like, you know, survivability as an indie and all this stuff getting started. And I was like, oh, I know Wally would be perfect for that. I wonder if she'd be interested. And she was, and so I suggested, I was like, hey, I can't do this, but this other person would be great for it. And now you're going to Dubai in like a week to speak. So it's like, even though it was really hard to turn that down, I was like, I can still imagine that work getting done by, it's important work, but it's getting done and it's gonna be okay. You don't have to do all the things. Like, other people will do it. It'll get done by somebody.
Yeah, I think sometimes we feel either a pressure or obligation or a sense of like, oh, it's gotta be done by me. Mm-hmm. And this can even happen in companies where we work. We're like, oh, if I wasn't there, what would happen? And the answer is the company would find someone to keep going. That's what businesses exist to do. If you died, they wouldn't go out of business, typically, right? And I don't mean that in a horrible way. I mean, like, there's this freeing element of this could get filled in. I could be replaced. And so there are things when I used to work on my educational stuff, and I was like, it's on me to work for people of every single skill level and so on. And I was like, no, like, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people a day also working on educating people in this sort of level, at this sort of angle, for this sort of purpose. I can pick a niche, be in that niche, focus on that, do that correctly, and not feel like it's up to me to somehow be obligated to cover every angle for every purpose of everybody. There's lots of other competent people out there pushing stuff that's totally equally worthwhile.
I think there was
another question. Was there a question in the back? Yes.
I think, so if you're unfamiliar with the Game a Week project, someone you should check out is Adriel Wallach. She did it for a year. She did an entire year where every week she finished a game. And I think, like, in this case, it's not that it's polished, but all the elements are there. Like, it does have UI. It, you know, it has some bugs, but there's some bugs fixed. And that sort of, the goal of that sort of exercise is getting an idea to like a recognizable completion and out in the pipeline. I think the next step to that is doing something that like a 3-month project. We're taking one of those and doing, like you said, take it to polish, because that amount of time it's hard, but it's what most of game development is. Most of game development is not making games, it's finishing games.
Yeah, so the 2D Boys, World of Goo, one of the early indie winners in sort of the scene, came out of one of those weekly experimental gameplay project kind of things. That's the case at Carnegie Mellon's graduate school. Crayon Physics came out of a monthly project where like it's one of the things that Clooney Games had come up with and decided this is worth throwing more energy at. 3 of my 12 iOS entertainment apps came from my daily experimental gameplay project things. Those were super unfinished, but out of that 219 things, I was able to reap a few things that were worth spending more energy on, like a week or two, and then doing things with those. So it depends on the purpose, but oftentimes it's kind of fishing for like what here is worth really throwing more energy at finishing.
I mean, I think it also really depends on, you know, the project and context for what you're working on. Like, if you're doing, like, one game a week, you know, maybe spend 6 days working on it and one day a polish and see how much polish you can get in bug fixing. And then, you know, as you get closer, you know, you more familiarized, try, you know, how much can you get done in 5 days and give yourself 2 days to polish. I think a big thing to remember too is that, you know, when you're setting a milestone, it's really just a date. You know, it's a date that's going to come whether your project is ready or not, and you just need to be able to present like the best thing possible and give everything that you could. But even if like games go out with bugs, you know, like professional AAA games go out with bugs, and it wasn't because, you know, they didn't care about it, they just ran out of time, because a milestone is a time, it's not necessarily a quantifier of the quality of a game.
Yeah, and another thing that I think we fail to put at the forefront is that, like, games take time. Like, games take a lot of time. If you choose to make games, you're not baking cookies. You're doing something that's going to take up a lot of your lifetime. So you have to decide, like, what does nice actually mean? And also, pivots happen. So you might spend all this time making something like really nice when that may not be something that ends up in your final game, because you're so focused on just a particular little element instead of just finishing something overall.
A related example is just recently on my streams, like last Saturday, I participated in this dev streamathon, and I had just 2 hours to stream, so I was like, I'll do a 2-hour game jam. I'll make a game in 2 hours, and it'll be fun. And, you know, pull an idea from my list, and I made it, and it was silly, but it was complete and great. And everyone was like, this is really funny. So the next stream I did, I was like, okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that 2-hour game jam, and I'm just going to look at it and do cost analysis and figure out how much it would take to make this game for reals. I'm just gonna like, do analysis on it. And spent a whole stream looking at things that I'd done really shoddily for the jam that would have to be, you know, fleshed out systems and all this different stuff. And I was like, you know, this would probably take, you know, 4 to 6 months to make for reals. And then it's like, would that be worth it? Would you know, could this game monetize? Was that worth my time? And in just thinking about that. And I think a lot of people don't have that practice of thinking about how much time it would actually take to make, you know, a cool little game that does really well as a jam, how much it would take to make that for reals, like an actual game that you can take to market. So just doing that exercise and being like, okay, how long I would have to do this, how long would that actually take, and how could I make this shorter, but then I'd have to hire someone, and so then, you know, it's a good exercise to do. But I think that it is a worthwhile experience to take a game to polish, because there is a lot you learn there as far as like how UI always takes 3 times longer than you expect it to, that you can't internalize that until you've done it. the whole saying of, you know, you complete 90% of the game and then like the last 10% is 90% of the work. And it's a saying that goes around, you can hear it, but you don't internalize that until you go through it. So I think that is also a worthwhile thing, but it's different. It's a different goal than doing a game jam or doing like a game.
I think, you know, one of the things that I really noticed too is that as I was applying to like a bunch of jobs, you know, when I was just graduating, a lot of the things said you have to have shipped 3 games, you know, and the key word there is shipped, because shipped implies that it's closed and you learn so much during that closing process.
Also, motivation is not an infinite resource.
Oh, no.
So the excitement that you have when you start a game, if it's not necessarily going to be there by the end. So you really have to, like really think about when you want to make something, like, nice. Like, what does nice actually mean? Because 3 months from now, you may not like what you're working on.
Yeah, the polishing process just feels very different. It can still be enjoyed. But it's obviously like it's early on, you're like, oh, I have all these ideas for spaceships. I have all these ideas for settings and characters and stories. And you're just opening up all these threads. And the last part's just walking around, tying up everything you can, cutting away the ones you can get away with cutting out. And it just has to be this much more kind of zen, just sort of pushing through it. It's kind of more like maybe a knitting experience, just continuous forward progress. But the crazy idea of what am I knitting is long behind you. And it is just time to finish that sock.
It takes discipline. You need when the motivation isn't there, then you have to rely on discipline to move you forward, and it's not always pleasant.
Or in habits yeah. To minimize the need to have to force yourself to do stuff. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned like in the job requirements thing where it was like three shipped games. One of the things I like to point out about these things, especially they affect people with imposter syndrome unfairly, is that, and this varies by company, so you know. That you can't go over there and be like, well, Chris DeLeon said. But often those are idealistic, optimistic things where they would love to find a human being who will have those requirements and do what they're willing to pay for that job. More often than not, people will go in there who like maybe meet 85% of it-ish, a bit of it. Maybe it's like, well, kind of not exactly that, but they're ready to learn that on the job kind of thing. And like you can totally go for those in many cases. Again, notwithstanding some chance, but we clearly said blank. And you're like, oh, sorry, misunderstood.
Nobody's closing that door for you except yourself.
Yeah. Don't see those and be like, well, but I haven't technically met all these bullets. Go after it anyway. Maybe the most qualified person who contacts them about it. Are there any other advice, tidbits, chunks, things you want to make sure you throw in there?
So there's this book called The War of Art. Not The Art of War, but The War of Art. And it's kind of this really good guide towards looking at creativity as like a developing discipline. You're going to hit plateaus, and the whole point of the book is recognizing that like when you hit a plateau, you shouldn't be waiting for creativity to strike, because when that, you know, motivation's gone, that discipline is going to kick in to get you towards finishing your game. But if you haven't built up that habit of developing a discipline, then you're not really supporting yourself.
I would say, once again, having a support network, especially if you can find people who are mentor figures to be in your life, to be open with for when you are feeling like a fraud, it is invaluable to have those relationships as a working developer. So get them. Easier said than done, I realize.
A question, then we'll go back to some sort of tidbits.
That's what I talk about all the time.
Yeah.
You should come to Indie Deaf Club if you're in LA.
You should.
So I have a friend, Eric. Shout out to Eric over there. And he was in a similar situation, and the only thing he's been able to do is literally just say, if I only have like even like an hour a day, I'm going to make sure 365 days a year, I'm still going to dedicate this 1 hour a day minimum towards my goals, and just making sure that you make that commitment to yourself, that you find like some little tiny stretch and just stick with it.
A friend of mine wrote this article about not breaking the chain, and he's a very like practical, like systems oriented person. So his thing is, even if I do one thing, like if I'm home and I'm about to collapse, if I go and just like write one line of code or change one adjustment or one like value in a stat on my game, that's enough as long as I do something every single day. So thinking about structures like that where it's like even just do one thing a day on your game, and it can feel like not a lot, but if you're the sort of person that's motivated by that and you're like, well, I've done this, I haven't broken the chain for like 270 days, do I really want to do that now because I'm exhausted? I'm just going to go change a thing. And it depends on what motivates you personally and stuff, but it's a similar.
I like lists. Like I use an app called Wonderlist. It's free. It syncs to my computer, and I just basically, I obviously fill it up way more than I check boxes off. But at least, you know, with the tasks written down, I won't forget it, and it's just up to me to go back and cross off things at my leisure.
I frame it like exercising. So I mean, people of all kinds of economic level, people of all kinds of busy levels, people, students, people, full time jobs, etc., find some way to maybe a few hours a week, right? Like maybe three mornings, maybe three evenings, maybe whenever it is, they find a point where they set aside an hour and they put themselves in that context where they're going to be on a treadmill, may as well be running on it. And so like if for 3 hours a week you have your IDE open or you have Photoshop open and you're sitting in front of it and like, well, this is what I'm doing for this hour, and my phone, I set it in the other room on silent, I guess I should fiddle and do something. And stuff will happen that wouldn't happen if you... And I really have a point of like, just open up and do anything for two reasons. One, sometimes you'll get carried away, which is great. And then it's like 3 a.m, you're like, oh, I'm going to feel like horse meat tomorrow. And the other thing that can happen is that like, if you... So with our clubs, we're hardcore, but like every single week we do something. And it's because if you go more than a week-ish, maybe two, but two is starting to get sketchy, without reopening your environment, it very quickly just slips away from you. That habit just appears, the project disappears, you're on a whole different thread, you come back to it later, and it looks like I'm getting all kinds of time signals from multiple people. can I give you like one last sentence per person-ish? All right.
You can do it.
Okay. Raise your hand if you've ever worked on a game in any facet. School. Okay, now repeat after me. I am a game.
A game.
Developer.
Developer.
Yeah. Look at how many people raised their hands, okay? Nobody had to have, like, some, like, metric or pass some test to qualify or say that, okay? Like this is where we all are. We all belong here.
Yeah, yeah.
Just do it. Go. I already said my tidbit.
And, like, just, like, make things. Just get stuff out of your system. Just, like, let it, like, vomit it out. Just get it out of your head. Even if it's just writing it out, just as long as you find a way for it to exist in some, like, physical form, that's better than it just being stuck in your head.
If you don't make it, who else will?
I'll make mine to be, try to find ways to make it not about you. Or sometimes the pressure can be like, oh, it's like, am I hurting myself? Because maybe I deserve to hurt myself. But if you look at, like, how you're holding back your possible talents to help other people, to make other good things that people enjoy, it becomes maybe easier to like, well, then you got to put yourself out there and get better at it to do things for other people. So that's probably it. But it seems like we're out of time. Thank you, everybody. Once again, names real quick down the line.
Wale.
Lisa.
Juan Vaca.
Chris.
Hey.